You know, I believe with all my heart that Father is looking for a people that will turn to Him and begin to do it the way that He designed to do church. You know, He told Moses, He said, Moses, I've showed you the pattern. Make sure that you do it just like I said to do it. You know, He showed Noah a pattern for an ark. And Noah had to do it just like Father showed him how to do it. And Father gave us a pattern for the way that the church is supposed to function and operate. And that pattern, it's easy to understand. It's unmistakable. On the day of Pentecost when the church was born, they were all baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire when suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. They were willing to be there. They were willing to be gathered together unto Him, waiting for the outpouring of His Spirit. They didn't have anything better to do like many of us have today. They were there waiting for the kingdom of God to come. They didn't understand all that was going to take place, but were there with one heart, one accord, one mind. All they wanted was heaven. They hadn't had an encounter with Jesus and found out that He was the King from another realm, and they wanted to be wherever He was at. Yeah, well, too many folks are caught away from the cares of this life. I'm going to tell you, you're worried about your family. Worry is not going to change them. I'm telling you right now, compromise is not going to impress them. But what would happen if you and I begin to cry out to God and say, Father, we want it Your way. You know, I don't know how to turn it. I don't know how to turn the ship because so many people have been indoctrinated into the wrong thing in the United States of America and the Western world. When I watch the move of God in third world countries, places where out in the back nowhere, where they're out in the back of nowhere, completely isolated from the Western influence, all I do is I behold with joy and wonder as the New Testament is reproduced in their life by the power of the Holy Ghost. You know, when we talk about the body of Christ, when Paul talks about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he talks about the body of Christ specifically in the context of the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. It is not even relevant to talk about the body of Christ without talking about the outpouring and manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit through each individual person, for that's the context in which it's given. To make it something else, once again, is to have another kind of church. You know, and the Lord tells us that here is this flow of the Holy Ghost available to us. And I pray that you'll allow your expectations to be changed. That suddenly you'll understand that there's a part and a role that you have to play as an heir of God and a co-inheritor with Jesus. And it's not about, you know, how comfortable you feel or how refreshed or tired you feel or whatever it is that you live by. It's about an assignment from heaven. It's about an authority that may cost you a lot. It cost Paul stonings, whippings, beatings, imprisonments. It's cost most of God's people today in the Western world very little. If they're tired, they stay home. Most of it's all about, you know, satisfying their own self-interest. If they're a little weary, they don't really enter in. They don't know how to break. They don't have enough anointing to break past just basic physiological functions. But if you would just unite with me, begin to hunger after God, and begin to just say, Father, we want church like You designed it. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 gives us a general overview of the manifestation of the Spirit that begins to work in all the individual members of the body as He divides severally to everyone as He wills. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 14 begins to focus in on that wonderful act of that of and manifestation of the Holy Ghost and the people that received Him. Because everybody who's been received the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, for the Spirit of the Lord has fallen upon all flesh, they prophesied. Everybody from the very beginning, when the anointing came upon them, they prophesied. And any time the anointing was there, they prophesied. And God has given to us an unlimited outpouring of His glory, but it's been compromised and it's been mixed with all the other stuff of this world. And Father's looking for a people that will be just so captivated with heaven that they would give themselves continually to this glorious realm. Father has given us the privilege to know Him in all the fullness of His glory, to be enriched with all the beauty and the splendor of His anointing. And so many people are opting out for other things. And I pray tonight that somehow you would become captivated by the Lord Jesus Christ, become a almost as it were a prisoner of the kingdom of God. I mean, Paul used that terminology, you know. But it's, you know, I think it's almost better to say a citizen of heaven. I mean, he was a prisoner because he got arrested for the gospel, you know. And he found himself not man's prisoner, but the Lord Jesus Christ's prisoner. Oh, if you and I begin to be sojourners and pilgrims in this earth, and you and I begin to willingly to turn our hearts towards heaven and understand the beautiful operation of the Spirit of God and the flow of the Holy Ghost, we cannot continue on allowing and occupying ourselves with things that are just ritual. But we're going to have to be willing, each one of us, to go over into a realm of heaven where the gift of God begins to explode in our emotions and our passions. Somebody said, I just don't have enough inspiration. It's because you've been eating too many worldly Twinkies. You've been consuming too much worldly, earthly food. And it's got you well stopped up. Because I'm telling you, God's got inspirations for us that just won't stop. And you're just going to have to be willing to say, look, you know, this is what God said, and I don't want to be denied, and no matter what it costs me, it doesn't matter what I got to do, I'm going to enter into this realm. Because once you enter this realm, I'm going to tell you right now, you'll never want to be a moment without this excessive, wonderful, beautiful pleasures of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And, you know, the Lord said, it makes it very clear that this is something that is so, once we begin to get into the flow of it and we begin to participate in the flow of it, it becomes excessive. It becomes so excessive that Paul has to say, listen, you know, make a little bit of room while you're just flowing in the spiritual. You're flowing in the expressions of the divine language. Make some room for prophecy. And he tells us to be zealots for the spiritual and zealots for prophecy and zealots for the things of the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. And it becomes such that he says to us, he says, being now zealots of spiritual gifts and excelling to edify the church, what are we going to do? He says, we're going to continue to now go ahead and we're going to pray in the language of the Spirit. And then we're going to pray with the understanding of the Spirit that then is the overflow of that. You know, I've asked the Lord over and again, Father, what does it take to get a shift from all the singing songs and the preaching sermons to begin to flow in the great exploits and the signs and wonders of your church that you said is the fullness of yourself, that you occupy with every gift, with every exploit, with every power to change every nation. And the Lord just constantly brings me back to his pattern. And he always is talking to us about what is the initial event. The initial event is the language and prophecy. It's not just the language of the Spirit. It's the language and the prophecy. And he brings it back to how is the church always functioning. You know, when Paul writes to the Corinthian church, this is many years after Pentecost, and we have a very clear proof and evidence that Pentecost was continuing to go on and that church services were exactly the same way. And that it would be such an overwhelm upon every single person that he said, go ahead, pray in the Spirit. Pray with the understanding also. In other words, an understanding that only the Holy Ghost can give that is the expression of revelation. It's the expression of doctrine. Because he said, how is it that every one of you has a revelation? Every one of you has a doctrine. Every one of you has a psalm. Every one of you has a tongue. Every one of you has an interpretation of that tongue. We've got false expectations. You think that you're supposed to sit here and listen to someone who flows in the anointing, and then you go home. And that has to change in your life. And he defines for us. He says, that's what I want going on. He says, I don't want just singing. I want you to sing in the Holy Ghost. But there are very few churches on the planet that are contending and pursuing what God wants. This is Pentecost. This is the outpouring of His Spirit. This is the revelation of the Messianic age, that Christ Jesus, the Messiah, has come and that He's King now. True. This is like busting through walls here, because this is busting through culture and busting through tradition and busting through mindsets and busting through ritual that has been fortified over and again by generations. And he says to us, and then sing with the understanding. And it always begins with the tongues, the language of the Spirit. I was telling some preachers not too long ago, I said, well, all you guys were so embarrassed of the Holy Ghost, you put him in the back room, and now he has no room. Some of them got upset, but many of them cried. Because it's this reality. People want to hold on. They don't want to change. They want to hold on to what they validated and believe is right, but it don't line up. Sorry, I spent too much time in the book. Sorry, I spent too much time asking questions and saying, Father, what's it supposed to look like? What's it supposed to be? And I pray that you become zealous for the Lord. You become zealots.
Yes, Father.
You become passionate about Father's house. About doing, quit trying to get God to do things your way. Let's go ahead and change and start doing it His way.
Yes.
Father doesn't want us to entertain you. I have no assignment to entertain you. I've been commissioned by God to equip you, to demand of you to repent, to change, to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, and to be every day taught of God. Don't get too excited. Don't get too excited that you should be taught every day by the living God. I mean, this is what God calls excellent praise. This is what He said to the woman that the Father was waiting on, seeking after. Those who would worship Him in the Holy Ghost. Those who would worship Him out of the depths of their being, in the inward parts, He desires truth. Something that can only happen because a miracle takes place and God the Holy Ghost comes to live on the inside of you. This is supposed to be so big in our lives and on the inside of us. That as I already said, how is it that every one of you hath the psalm? Every one of you has a doctrine interpretation of tongues. And then he goes on to say, it's so big that every one of you may prophesy one by one. I mean, you know, there are so many times I can feel the anointing of the prophet, the anointing of prophecy in the place. And it's all that I can do to shut my mouth and stop prophesying and give place for someone else to prophesy. But then I'm quiet and I don't hear anything. And it's not just here. It's everywhere, it seems, because people are under the intimidation and the gag order of the demonic. They're under the influences of the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches and the pleasure of this world and their own pursuits of life. And I pray that you let the fire of God burn upon your life and burn up the cords tonight.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That binds you.
Thank you, Jesus.
And if you're not bound, then go ahead and prophesy. And if you're not bound, then go ahead and flow. And if the well's not stopped up, then go ahead and be sensitive to that which God the Holy Ghost is doing, because He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. What He's doing in His church, He's not changed. It lasts forever. Hallelujah. Forever. Hallelujah. People think that the Apostle Paul is some kind of an exception, some kind of unique event. No, he's just a model believer. Just a model believer. Come on, people, start raising your children to prophesy, but guess what? They're not going to prophesy if you don't. Start raising your children to participate with the glory of the outpouring of this glorious thing that happens in the church, this wonderful manifestation of the Spirit, that which is resident here. You know, when you turn back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Lord tells us very clearly what's resident in the church. It says in verse 28, He says that what's resident in the church is that He put there first apostles, and secondarily after that He put prophets, and then after that He put teachers, and then after that he put miracles. They're just resident. They're here. They're resident. By virtue, it's the church. They're here. You don't have to pray them down or look around. They're here. You just got to be able to respond to the Spirit of the Lord. So many people don't know how to respond to the Spirit of the world, the Lord, because they responded to the spirit of the world. I tell you, virtue and power are connected. I tell you, purity and the demonstration of God's glory in and to, through your life are connected. I tell you, they are. Tonight I pray that you'll give yourself to a revival, that you'll give yourself to an awakening, that you'll give yourself to a turning back to God, that you'll quit doing it your own way. You'll forget about false models. Somebody said, how can I know false models? Read the true book. Read the book. Read the model. Read the true model. And then don't be willing to be without it. Don't sit around and say there's something wrong with me. Go ahead and let God, the Holy Spirit, fill you with faith and lay hold on that which is available. Here tonight, there's miracles.
Yes. Amen.
Here tonight, there's gifts of healing. Here tonight, there's tongues. And interpretation of tongues. People don't like the tongues and interpretation of tongues. They don't have many healings either. They don't have any many miracles because they put out the fire of the Holy Ghost. Don't do that. Don't put out the fire. Tonight we pray in the name of Jesus. You just let the fire just begin to burn right now. Upon your head, in your belly. Tonight we pray that you begin to give yourself to a flow. Give yourself to a flow. We're not interested. You know, there's so many people setting up studios in their church because they want to produce CDs. It's wrong motives. Forget about CDs. The world's not interested in you and me. But they are interested in Jesus, the Savior. They're interested in a Savior.
Yes.
And the only way that we're ever going to be able to show them the Savior is when we begin to participate with the one who's come to reveal him, and his name is the Holy Spirit. And you may not like the Holy Ghost, but I tell you right now, I like him and I love him, and I'll do anything he wants, and whatever he's described, I'm going after. I'm not going to have another gospel. I'm not going to belong to another church. I'm not going to live by another creed. I'm going to do it God's way, as he's described in his word, and he's made it so simple. Somebody said, is the ministry of Jesus Christ still alive? Yes, if you'll do it. Yes, if you do it. If you do not do it, his ministry is not alive, because I'm going to tell you right now, he's left it for the people within the framework of the church, his body, his manifest presence. And I want to turn back. I want to turn back. I've been in the church all of my life, and I want to turn back. I want to be a part of the church that's described in the Bible. I want to be a part of the ministry of Jesus. There can't be another ministry. It has to be his ministry. I want him to come and be manifested and revealed in our midst and in our lives. Because that's what the anointing is all about, to reveal the life and power of the person, Jesus Christ. And somebody said, I'm not Jesus. Well, yeah, that's true, but he's commanded you to live his life. Not willing? Why? Why not? Can't? Why the doubt, the unbelief? Tonight, in the name of Jesus, I pray that every person in this place, I'm getting ready to be gone for 30 days, and I pray that every person in this place that belongs to this ministry will say, enough is enough. I'm tired of just playing ritualistic church. I'm tired of just going with another idea. I'm going to do it God's way. If I can't be sensitive to the Holy Ghost right now, I'm going to understand how to have Pentecost in my life. Hallelujah. The baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire has two evidence. Two. It's highlighted in Acts 19:6. They begin to speak with other tongues, the language of the Spirit, and they begin to prophesy. Father, I want you to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Somebody said, how do you know? It's the ministry of Jesus. It's his heavenly ministry right now. His earthly ministry, glorious and wonderful. He died at Calvary's cross. He went down into hell. He raised up from the dead. But as soon as he started his heavenly ministry, he began to baptize people in the Holy Ghost and fire. And his ministry hasn't come to an end. Hallelujah. So I want you to receive right now. God, Christ Jesus, is baptizing you, wants to baptize you. He loves you. He does not want to leave you oppressed. There are people in this place, you're oppressed with depression and with sorrow. I can feel it. I sense it. I'll break that thing off of you tonight because Christ Jesus has commanded me to. We want to see you go free from that and start living this wonderful life of joy, unspeakable and full of glory. Listen, it's not a ha-ha, hee-hee. Give me a break. It's so much deeper than that. I live, don't tell me about the joy. I live in the joy. Don't tell me about the joy, ha-ha, hee-hee. Give me a break. The joy is something that takes over every cell of your body. Hallelujah. Woo! I'm telling you, the love of God, come on, man. It shines bright through your eyes. It sends beams of heaven into those that you look at. Come on now. Come on now. I'm done with the abuses. I'm done with walking all over the anointing. I'm done with trampling all over the Holy Ghost and then wondering why it is he doesn't move much. You know what I'm saying to you? Hallelujah. I want you to be done with it too. I want you to be done with entertainment and recognize that there's a responsibility that rests upon your shoulders to be endued with power from on high and go everywhere as a flaming evangel fire representing the King of the Kingdom, showing forth his mighty power and love and grace through your life. Come on now. Some of you haven't even been bivocational. In other words, you're full-time ministry and full-time at the job. Some of you just basically been full-time at your job. It's about time you get a heavenly vision. I mean, come on now. Come on now. It's about time that you get a heavenly vision. Hallelujah. It's about time you start looking up instead of looking down. It's about time you get a heavenly vision. See yourself in the ministry. Because that's how God sees you. He sees you in the ministry. Hallelujah. You start seeing yourself in the ministry and all of a sudden you'll begin to get a seriousness about God that you didn't have before, and you'll begin to see a response from heaven that you didn't have it before either. And the Lord makes it really simple. He says, draw nigh to me and I'll draw nigh to you. You know everybody who has been drawn near to the Lord because you can see that he's near to them. So we pray tonight that you'll understand how easy these things are just to participate with God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Turn this thing up. Turn this thing up. The fire of God begins to burn upon your head. I see it. I see the fire of God burning on your head. I see the glory of heaven all over you right now. This is what Father is doing. You go ahead and you receive right now. You go ahead and let your heart begin to be hungry and thirsty after the things of heaven. And you watch how God will fill you right now. He's not leaving anybody out. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus. Lord, there's so many people in here tonight that need change. They need miracles. They need miracles in their body. They need miracles in their spirit. There's people in here tonight that have never understood how to live free from sin. They're constantly being hooked back into an addiction. Satan just kind of lays around, just waits, and he gets you every 2 weeks, every 2 months, whatever. I want to see that thing broken off of you tonight. God wants to break it off of you. He wants to show you how to live with the greater one on the inside of you, who's bigger than any demon of hell or sin or iniquity on the outside of you. The church is supposed to be this place of great healing. The church is the healing balm, the solution to the crisis of the world. Somebody said, how is it that we are going to redeem the time, for the day is evil? God says, be filled with the Spirit. We have the solution to redeem the day and the time. We, right here in this church, Satan knows it, and that's why he entangles you in the things and entraps you in the things that you allow, that would keep your life from being that which can participate with such a redemption. So tonight I pray that you become valiant. I pray that you become ferocious, fierce.
Yes, amen.
Fierce.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Fierce.
Thank you, Jesus.
Fierce. A Holy Ghost, radical, fierce manifestation of heaven and God's power. That isn't going to come easy. That's going to cost you everything. If you think you can continue to live your life consumed with your job and the world and have these things, you're fooling yourself. It's about time people understand that this life is short. Soon we will leave out of this realm and we will go into the next realm, and that next realm is a place that it's fixed. It's fixed. Things aren't fixed right now. You can change. Tonight you can choose to be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, to walk as one of his disciples, baptized in the Holy Ghost and power, being those who are heirs of God and going heirs with Christ Jesus, living in a realm called heaven. It's not fixed. You have the opportunity to be changed. But when you step out of this life into the next, it's fixed forever. Heaven or hell. The glory of the Lord, or the curse and the darkness of cohabitation with demon spirits throughout the ages. The beauty and the splendor of his life and his creation that can't even be made fully manifested with words and descriptions now, because it goes beyond all that we could even think or ask or imagine. Or a place called the Lake of Fire, where the worm or the disgusting soul never perishes, neither is the flame quenched. That's how Jesus said it. He said there's things that must be cut off. He said, cut it off. If your hand offend you, cut it off. Your foot offend you, cut it off, or cause you to stumble. If your hand causes you to stumble or causes you to sin, cut it off. If your foot causes you to stumble or sin, cut it off. If your eye causes you to stumble or sin, tear it out. Cut it off. And he says repeatedly, why? Because God's judgments are sure. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we thus persuade men, and we live in a time where people don't believe there is any judgment. Why? Because a prince and power of the air called secular humanism runs the show of so many people's lives. Tonight we're calling you over to a realm of giving your life over to Christ Jesus and living in his life and living in his realm of love and peace and goodness. You have the opportunity. Believe you me, God's word does not change. You don't have to wonder if I'm right or the other preacher that you've been listening to is right. Just read your Bible. Amen. Just that simple. I'm going to tell you tonight, there is going to be things that God is going to show you has to be cut off of your life. And if you're serious enough with God that you're going to cut off one of your appendages, I'm certain you will find a way to cut off all the other stuff. It simply has no place. Some people's lives are taken. I mean, some people really believe that their laptop computer is one of their faculties and appendages now. Some people need to cut that thing off because you don't have the wherewithal and the knowledge of God or the self-control in the spirit to not look at the wrong things. You listening to me? You cut the stuff off. You don't need a computer. Your forefathers got along just fine without them. In fact, you got along just fine without them 20 years ago. Huh? Come on, people. Let's come on now. Come on now. We just want to get everything out of the way that would hinder us from enjoying the realms of divine power and glory that Christ Jesus made a way for us through the veil of his flesh to enter into, so that we have access by the Holy Ghost. We want to get everything out of the way so that we can completely and fully cooperate with him. Hallelujah. Why don't you just go ahead and prophesy? A little stuck, huh? Just a little stuck, isn't it? I understand. I know the dynamics. I'm just helping you to understand your limitations. Because I'm going to tell you, in the not too distant future, it isn't going to just be ever so often when I catch you at the right moment, I get a bunch of prophecies and tongues and interpretation of tongues. But you live in it. I live in it. I prophesy. You wake me up in the middle of the night, I'll prophesy. Hallelujah. Because I'm just going to continue to be filled with the Spirit. I'm going to obey God. I'm going to continually be filled with the Spirit, speaking to myself in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. I'm not interested in nothing else. And we want you tonight, get your interest all placed where they need to be. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. That's right. Don't stop short of a breakthrough. Don't stop short of a breakthrough. You guys stop. She always. Let me just tell you this. People practice stopping short of a breakthrough. Wrong thing to practice. Practice every time breaking through into a realm of joy, into a realm of glory, into a realm of his manifest presence. I'm going to tell you right now, you may not believe me. You may not have the understanding and the knowledge to believe me. But there is a realm of his manifest presence that you can always live in and have. And we want to open that door of understanding to you so that you begin to do whatever you got to do to have what he's made available. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, Jesus. Holy Spirit, come glorify Jesus in this place. We pray that every man would be healed, that the person of man would not be seen. That only a glory would be seen. Oh, Lord, that everyone would understand that they are on holy ground in this place. That their life is sacred. That your things are sacred. That the sacred, yes, wonderful realm of the Holy Spirit, the sacred Spirit is here. And that everything that you have for us is far better than anything we could ever have or obtain in this world. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Listen, I want you to get ready because Evangelist Tim Hall is going to come, and I mean, we're just believing for great breakthroughs for you. I've asked Tim to just pour out upon you and seed you to go after evangelism, to just be that much more excited about signs, wonders, and miracles. I'm telling you right now, because it's just, if you get excited about what God has done, and I'm telling you, become a zealot for the spiritual, you're going to have it.
Hallelujah.
You're going to have these things. Father's more earnest about his manifest power and glory being revealed through you than you are earnest about having it. And I hope tonight that every one of you are earnest about the glory of God being made manifest through your life. It's a wonderful thing to see people set free. Whole nations are brought to God by one miracle. The nation of Georgia was brought to its knees and became the first Christian nation because of one miracle that happened. One miracle. By a little slave girl who was brought from Cappadocia to Georgia. One slave girl. One miracle. Whole nation. Come on now. And so tonight we're going to be here with Evangelist Tim Hall tonight, tomorrow night, and Tuesday night. And I want you to press in. I want you to lay hold on that which God would do through your life if you just have an encounter with Jesus and begin to believe that all these things that he said that he's purposed you to do, that you can do them. Just rise up and begin to start flowing in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And so every night this week, every night of the meetings this week, tonight, Monday night, and Tuesday night, we're going to be receiving just special offerings just for the crusades that Tim is going to be doing this year. He's going to tell you more about that here in just a minute. And so I want you to be a part of that. I know that many of you have really been just giving sacrificially for all the things that we're doing, but we just love sowing into what everybody else is doing as well. So it is spread it out there, you know. And who knows? I mean, it'd be great just to think that this church was basically involved with, you know, a dozen crusades a month throughout a dozen different nations, that we were just taking nations with our finances. Hallelujah. Taking nations with their prayers. Everybody's got a role to play. The Hebrides revival. I mean, the Hebrides revival. Two old ladies, 82 and 84. Got down on their face before God and began to touch heaven, took hold of heaven. God answered their prayer. They knew where the outpouring of the Spirit was going to take place. I mean, come on. They were able to assign the pastor what place to go to that was going to be ripe for the picking. They were able to understand the strategies of the Spirit that Tim was referring to this morning, where if you move there, faith is going to bust loose and it's just going to spread like a fire. Amen. Come on, people. God's got more work for you to do than you've been engaged in. So I pray that you'll get resourced tonight by heaven. Amen?
Amen.
And so I want you to give your resources as you begin to be resourced. Hallelujah. So I'm going to go ahead and receive an offering now. I'm going to let, you know, Tim get up and tell you a little bit more about what's going on. But, you know, there's in the offering baskets are out here most of the night. And so while preaching's going on. So if you give now and decide you want to give more later tonight, I want you to know you're always free to come give more. Okay? I don't want anybody to be limited. I don't want you to be limited on your giving. How many of you tonight just want God to be limited on how much he gives you? Everybody who wants God to be limited on how much he gives you, I want you to raise your hand. I don't see anybody wanting God to be limited. Any of you guys going to restrict how much God's going to give you tonight? He wants to give you everything that he has. He's made available everything that he has. It's about your willingness to receive all that he has, because it's about your willingness to live the life that he's chosen for you, his life. So I want everybody just to stand with me so you can get to your wallets. And I want you to come and I'm going to get you to get ready, because I want you to bring an offering unto the Lord. Honey, you got an offering ready? Look at that. She came. My wife comes, and this ain't a small offering either. This feels pretty heavy. She got some stuff in here. Huh? She gets it all laid out before she even gets here. Hallelujah. Wrapped up in a Ziploc bag. She's not going to appear before the Lord empty-handed. Huh? Many times our prayers are all prayers about what God's going to do for us. No, what are you going to do for him? He's already done everything for us. He's already done everything for us. And as we begin to respond to him, it opens up provision for us. That's why he says, you give, and I will cause all grace to abound unto you, so that you will have all sufficiency in all things. Does that sound like God left anything out there?
No.
All sufficiency in all things sounds to me like God left nothing out. Amen. So come and worship the Lord where you're giving. Tim?
Hallelujah. 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 What a wonderful God we serve. How are you, Tyler? How's the Marines? Bless you guys. Thank you for that. Pastor said he's going to take an offering each meeting, and Jackie and I, we won't touch that offering. That offering, everything that comes in, is going into this thing we're doing in Vanuatu, and I have a feeling that it broke out last time, so that in a city of 40,000, 14,000 of them were saved, but the whole nation was shaken, and we're going back. We're taking 80 people. We train them every day, and I just have a feeling in God that whole nation can come to Christ, the whole nation. And I believe the whole South Pacific Rim. My passion is to see the South Pacific Rim come to Christ. And we've got stuff. I don't know how many people are going on teams with us this year. I think the day's got to come when we do something together and have a whole bunch from here. Then you and I do a crusade and we'll bring a whole bunch from here and a whole bunch of Aussies. And I'll bring a whole lot of unmarried Aussie men over to meet all the unmarried American girls. And I mean, at one stage there, Dan, we were looking for an Aussie girl, but you've actually found a girl who's just even better than Aussie girls. I mean, she's magnificent. Yeah, our Aussie girls are all right, though. They're all right. Especially out in the bush. They live out there. G'day, how you going? All right. I feel the presence of God. I feel a great mixture of jet lag and the presence of God. I went home this afternoon and just crashed. The next thing I heard was a voice saying, "Tim, you ready?" I don't even know if I'm alive. And I. But God's going to do something. What I'd like to do, just for a couple of minutes, and you may have seen this before, I don't know, but this is my 40th year of ministry. Been going for 40 years, which it doesn't sound long, does it, really? But 40 years. I had a guy come up the other day, and I was in Perth doing a conference in Perth, and he came up to me and he said, "Tim, Pastor Tim," he said, "you don't remember me, do you?" I said, "No." He said, "These are my kids." He said, "My name is such and such." I said, "Good to meet you." Shook hands with him. He said, "These are my children." He said, "I've got three children. This is two of them. This one's 20 years of age and this one's 18. And I wanted them to come and hear you, because," he said, "I first heard you on a youth camp when I was 17. He said, "I'm 47 now. And I wanted my kids to hear you." And the scary thing is that, you know, I've done a lot of drawings for the kids here, but I had a lady come up there a while back. She's in her 40s with teenage kids, late teens, these kids, maybe 20s. And she said, "I want to show you a book of cartoons you did when you stayed at our house when you preached in Ballarat." How many have ever been to Ballarat? It's a big town. It's bigger than Bella Mouse, but not much. It's and you realize that you've been touching generations for 40 years. Never taken long service leave at any stage in 40 years. Don't know what it is. Very few holidays. Have a few on the run. And someone says, "Do you take holidays and go off?" I did. I took Jackie to Israel, and I took her to Turkey, down to the seven churches of Revelation. And when I go home, we're going to this tropical paradise called the Whitsunday Islands. And we're going to put our feet up. And I'm going to find that large pair of swimmers, and I'll just go and lie down by the pool like a beach whale for about 5 days when I get home. But it's been an adventure. We've preached all over the world, preached in every continent except the Antarctic, and we are, as I've said before, going down there to do a huge conference with sea lions and penguins. It should be powerful. And it's a blur. I look back on a blur. 40 crusades in New Guinea. One occasion I had a phone call, and the government had requested we come. the government requested. And they said, would you come? Crime has been so bad in Moresby. We want you to come. We will pay for the stadium, your air ticket. We will pay for your accommodation. The Deputy Prime Minister picked me up. He was my driver. I had a carload of police with flak jackets and shotguns. And they escorted us to the hotel. We ran for 23 nights. 30 or 40,000 people saved on that crusade as God poured out His Spirit. We had meetings where, I remember one night in one of the meetings in Papua New Guinea where I was in Bougainville, and God said, wave your hand over the crowd, and from front to back, 10,000 people went out in a wave under the hand of God. We've seen the dead raised on two occasions in our meetings, held a little boy that had been dead for 30 minutes in my arms. They stuffed this little boy in my arms right when I was preaching, and we got everybody to take authority, and I had the joy of hearing his breath and seeing his eyes come alive, and handed him back to his mother. We had another little fellow who'd been dead for nearly two hours from the hospital in New Guinea, pushed into the arms of one of our team. And that little child, we were ministering in over a foot and a half of water in a flood, and the people were praying for them in Jesus' name, and they were being healed and baptized in water, both at the same time. It was like, in Jesus' name, and into the water, splash, and healed by the power of God. And that little child, still with a tube from its nose that had been dead for several hours, came alive, given back to the mother. There's something about this glorious gospel. There's something about this gospel of power. Something about this supernatural manifest. I remember the first time I went to Pakistan. And went into Pakistan. The reason I went was I didn't know anyone that had been there. And I thought, I still have that feeling that I like to go places that others are nervous to go. There's just something satisfying about going in there when people are nervous to go in there. As God says, He can get you into any country. No guarantee you're coming out, but He can get you in there. There's no problems with that. And Pakistan, I remember the first trip into Pakistan, preaching next to a mosque and hearing the sound of the call to prayer and hearing all these stories. And I remember after the first night, I was so scared to go for souls. You know, they said, whatever you do, don't say anything that's going to, you know, upset Muhammad, or don't say anything about the religion here. Be careful what you say. And I remember the first night getting up, and we had a crowd out there. First night was probably 6,000. And I preached, and I thought, I went for healing, because Isa is in the Quran, and I preached, and powerful anointing of God, people got healed, and I said to the pastor, you can go for souls, see if you can get some people saved. And I went home and looked in the mirror, and I said, why didn't you pull the net in tonight? And I rebuked myself. I said, you gutless wonder, you go out there tomorrow night, and you don't go for souls, I will personally beat you up. I will thrash you. You'll get a black eye. Two black eyes, maybe three. And I got up the next night and preached. And I preached on Jesus, the way, the only way, the Son of the living God. The door, the way, the truth, the life. And the hair on my neck was standing up on end. And then we had this great hall of souls come down, people weeping down at the front. And then I thought, now we get right into business. And on about the fourth night, I was going in there. As I was going in, I heard the devil say to me, you're going to get shot tonight. I went, oh, that's not good. And then I had this incredible feeling. It's a good night for it. I wouldn't mind tonight. I actually thought, I think getting shot tonight wouldn't be bad, as long as the Pakistanis aren't good shooters. Their accuracy is not great. Well, if it's anything like cricket, they drop catches and they're not that accurate. So I don't know what they're like with a rifle. But I thought if they shoot straight, and I was going to borrow, I don't know if the ladies wear lipstick, I don't think they do, but I was going to borrow something and draw a big bullseye and try and hit about. If you're going to hit properly. And I actually that night thought, martyrdom's all right. And I could smell the air, and the crowd was there, probably were up to about 20,000, 25,000 people. And it was like, yeah, this is a good night for it. If you're going to go, it's a good night to go. And, you know, you never know what's going to happen. You don't know. That's the exciting thing about just going to the nations. You just don't know. That excitement, you feel good when you're on the edge. Yeah? Well, it's nearly 40 years. It's nearly 40 years. It is 40 years. It's a long time. How many are not yet 40? Yeah, see, I was preaching before you were born. Before you were born. Who's 40? Just 40. Who's exactly 40? Who's over 40? The ancient ones. Anyone over 50? Anyone over 60? Over 65? That's thinned it out, isn't it? Anyone over 65? The really ancient ones, the baby boomers. I tell the kids that I was born just after the Second World War. Let me ask you a question. I'm going to digress for a moment. Let me get some volunteers here. All right. What year did the Second World War finish? No, don't yell out. Now, 45. What year was the Vietnam War, Dan? All right. Finish. I missed that by one day. I missed going by one day to Vietnam. What year was the First World War, Josh? No. 1914 to 1918. When did the Beatles, the demonized Beatles, put out their first song? Stewie? Stewie. No idea. Take five house marks. 1964. I want to hold your hand. And then they got all demonized, messed up, and drugs, and thought they were more popular than Jesus. John Lennon probably found that when he stood before Jesus, he wasn't. But it's a different generation. It's a different. But the joyous thing for me has been ministering to people over not just one or two generations. Now it feels like it's about six. But it's sort of getting into a place. I did conferences for a church in Perth recently. I've done their youth camp, their children's camp, their children's conference, their youth conference, their men's conference, their church. And now I'm just waiting to be called to do their women's conference. That'll be the next. But it's been 40 years of excitement and miracles and just extraordinary. I may talk about some of the miracles we've seen the next few nights. Watching a little kid with autism one night go home completely normal in a normal school. Had a meeting, 5 years of age. Jesus met him while he lay on the floor. He went home completely set free from autism. Things happen and it's a blur. It's a blur of incredible things. I watched an 18-year-old boy walk across the great stadium in Port Moresby, looking at everything, yelling and looking because he'd never seen for 18 years, and walked up on the platform trying to describe the colours and the things that he was seeing in sheer amazement as another world opened to him. A lady came up one day and she said, "Do you recognize this young girl? Pretty girl, 15 years of age, a beautiful girl, and beautifully dressed, elegant young girl. Do you recognize her?" I said, "No." She said, the mother said, "Well, she was dying in hospital with every major organ in her body shut down, given hours to live, and you came into intensive care, and you laid your hands upon, or you came in and put your hand against the glass and prayed over the glass, and she was home in a few days, and here she is." And I thought, one day some guy's going to marry this beautiful girl, and if I find out who it is, I'll go and talk to him and say, "Listen, we got a crusade coming up. I think 15 or 20,000 for the crusade. That'd be fair enough." I am joking. But what I want to do, just for a couple of minutes, just for 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes, and you may have seen it before, some of it, and there's some new stuff and some old stuff for about 2 minutes on a DVD. Or a CD or a tape or a cassette or a vinyl or something. But we'll just have a look for a minute. And I'm going to preach a short message. God's going to release people tonight into something, something strong in God. And so I don't know where it shows. I was looking for a screen. I thought, well, praise God. There it is. There it is. So just a two-minute little flash of some of the stuff. Some of it's old, and some of it's fairly recent.
Listen, this arm was twisted since she was a child.
It's Pakistan.
And now the twisted arm has gone straight. That is an absolute miracle from God. That is a miracle from God. Lift him up.
Amen.
He couldn't walk, now he's walking. Now he's walking. Now he's walking. Now he's walking.
Some exciting stuff there. We went into Myanmar, Burma, and the opportunity was there, and they said, would you be interested to go? And I said yes, and I got hold of the Planet Shakers band, the full band actually, and you say, what did that cost to take them? Well, I had to raise about $50,000 to take the band in, but it was fantastic. We went into a number of areas, went twice. The first time they came with us for two nights and the next time for about five. But we went out to places that had been closed. We went by truck on a road, by bus on a road that I wish they'd told us that three buses had gone off it in the previous year. The musicians were looking over the side, straight down for about a lot of feet. And we got out there, there's 10,000 people out there. And the Spirit of the Lord hit that place, cripples, and probably 60% of them got saved. And we went back to Kalamu and ministered there. I had food poisoning. We think we ate dog, because I know I was barking for a couple of days, and I was projectile vomiting all day. Projectile. I mean, it was Guinness Book of Records stuff. And my wife said, "You can't preach tonight." I said, "Jackie, there's going to be 25,000 people out there. I'm going to preach even if I'm dead." And I was vomiting all day, just sick. And I'd say, "How long to go?" She says, 5 hours. I said, "All right, just let me lie here." "Okay, thank you, Jesus." "How long to go?" 2 hours. I'm thinking, "Oh, God, I think I can make it." And about an hour and a half before, I staggered up and the shower was unusual style, cold. Basically, it was a bucket of water tipped over your own head. It was powerful. Got out of that, got dressed, and I said, I think I'm going to die, Jackie, but I'm going to preach. And I remember sitting at the meeting going, this is very interesting. And then I was just about to go up and preach, and I went, over by the edge of the stage and really called out to Ralph for a while. Ralph! Swilled some water around, staggered on the platform and preached for an hour, and we probably had 8,000 saved that night. And then the miracles just broke out and the glory of God. And then we went to what was formerly called Rangoon, which is now Yangon. And we spent a lot of money, but hired a large hall right in the middle of Yangon. And we were preaching in the afternoon. We had it for the afternoons from 1 o'clock until 4. And so we had some great meetings there, but then some people came up to me and said, there's an evangelist hasn't arrived from Holland or Germany, and there's a big crowd, but it's a 2.5-hour drive out there. So what you'd have to do is finish the first crusade meeting and then drive for 2.5 hours and preach another crusade meeting and drive home another 2.5 hours. I said, yeah, okay, great, great. If there's a mob like that out there waiting for a preacher, I'm in. And people said, you sure you can do this, Pastor Tim? You're not as young as you used to be. I said, look, if there's a crowd of people that need the touch of God, it's over broken glass if we have to. And, well, judgment of time in Myanmar is a bit different. Myanmar time, it was 4 hours. I got there and preached 4 hours home. And they said, look, the opportunity's there to do it tomorrow. You don't want to do this again, do you? I said, absolutely. Just get a faster driver. That was a bad suggestion. He was quicker. Complete mental case. We did. My wife said, what have you got us into? I said, I don't know. I think we'll survive. There's a chance. She's 50-50. Got out there, and here's this massive crowd waiting out there. Those altar calls at the end, that was one of those was out there. And got out there and preached. And at the end, the Spirit of the Lord was there, and they brought a little child up that was been in a coma for weeks. And I said, everybody starts shouting. And I said, you hold that little child up, and everybody just point your hand and start to shout. And as we shouted, that little child came out of the coma and stood on the ground. And that helps a meeting. That helps a meeting. That someone say, that helps a meeting. That helps a meeting. We were in a meeting one night in Guadalcanal, and there was a guy lying by the side of the platform. I don't want to tell you all these. I wasn't even going to tell you stories tonight, but you probably could enjoy one or two. He's lying on a bed in Guadalcanal, on a battle site right near the Matanikau River. And this guy, he'd been in a vegetative state for a long period of time. He was lying there by the platform. And we had another situation just like this one, but even better later. But miracles were breaking out, and the glory of God was just like a fire in the place. And suddenly this guy stood up, and people started to scream. And the guy walked up onto the platform holding his bed, put his bed down, and the place went mad. And then crutches and sticks were being thrown on the platform, and the crowd grew from about 5,000 or 6,000 that night. And we finished up with a full stadium, with the government putting on buses to get people to the crusade, free bus trips to the crusade, kids escaping from their dormitories at the school. And I got invited into the Prime Minister's office, and he said, it's the biggest thing in our country since independence. You want to come again, you contact me personally. And it's been 40 years of stories of a blur of extraordinary movings of God's power and God's Spirit. And I'm 70 in 2 years, but somehow I'm asking God, just what do you want me to do to get ready for the next great stage? Because I'm going to have another stage. Someone said, you're going to retire and do what? Get a hat, a Volvo, a cat, a rocking chair, and grow tomatoes? No. No. All due respect to anyone with a hat, rocking chair, Volvo that's growing tomatoes, or tomatoes, but we call them tomatoes. Potatoes and tomatoes. It's either got to be potatoes and tomatoes or potatoes and tomatoes. But in our case, it's potatoes and tomatoes, which is incorrect English. But who cares? But I'll preach briefly tonight that God is raising a different generation. God is raising a generation that is different to any generation that the church has ever known. There's never been, the early church didn't have the opportunities and didn't have in front of it the possibilities that we have. Father, would you anoint what I share right now? Anoint your word and touch us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The early church did not have the opportunity we've got. The early church, the world was nothing like it is now. In scope, possibility of arriving at places, the chance to be in another nation within hours, within a day, you can be across the world from one situation, standing on a platform in a completely different part of the world. It's a different age. It's a different time. The world is probably in the worst state it's ever been in history. People look at the ancient world and talk about the violence of the ancient world. The world has never seen the wars, the brutality that the world's seeing right now. There are more people in slavery right now, in human bondage, than at any time in human history. The biggest money earner on the planet right now is not drugs, it's human trafficking. We're in a world right now where countries that were once safe are no longer safe. We live in a world right now where everything that we thought was stable a few years ago is no longer stable. I was stunned when Pan Am went down some years ago, when it folded as a company. But we're looking at a time now when it's not going to be big companies folding up, but whole nations. The world is in uncertainty like never before. Never has the world been in a more uncertain state than it is right now. That's why Joel wrote, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. People don't know where things are going. People are uncertain where things are going. They are waiting for something. In fact, the whole of creation right now is waiting for something. The scripture says in the book of Romans that the whole of creation is eagerly waiting for something significant. They're waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. They're waiting for the revelation, the showing forth of the sons of God. The nations are groaning. The nations are uncertain. The nations are critical. The nations are cynical. But they're waiting for something. I think the church, I think the world has been, I think in America, the world has been disappointed by the church. I think in Australia, the nation has been disappointed by the church. They've expected more of the church. They're waiting for the church to be a voice. But see, the world right now is in the original language, as I understand in the Greek, that eagerly awaiting, that earnest expectation, the whole picture there is of one stretching their head and looking and wondering and waiting, where are the sons of God and the daughters of God? Where are they? Who are the sons of God? My Bible says that we are sons. In fact, it says we are now the sons of God. We are joint heirs with Christ. We are one spirit with Him. We are filled with the same mighty Holy Spirit. Christ is in us, the hope of glory. We are born again by the Spirit of the living God. If the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in us, He shall also raise our mortal body. We are not just a bunch of people carrying a Bible around. We are a new creation, totally new. We are a brand new creation. Paul wrote, and he said, I pray the eyes of your understanding, and I preached on this a bunch of times here probably, would be enlightened that you can know the expectation of your calling and the might of the glory that's yours in inheritance in the saints, and to know the unlimited magnitude of almighty power that is towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power which he exerted in the dead body of Jesus when God raised him from the dead. He said, I want you to see what's available to you. He said, I want you to see in Ephesians the surpassing greatness of his power that is towards us. He said, I want you to see what's at your disposal. I want you to see what you're carrying. I want you to stop seeing your limitations and see who you are in the resurrected Christ. He says, I want you to see that you are filled with all the fullness of God. You've been filled with all the fullness of God. And now as a result of that, he is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything you could ask, think, dream, imagine, contemplate. What are we contemplating? What are we dreaming? What things are going through our minds? What things do we want to do? What stuff do you want to do? What stuff do I want to do? What do we want to achieve? I want to, before I go off to glory, I want to stockpile for heaven multitudes, 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 vast seas of humanity swept into the kingdom of God. Young men, young women, fired up and inspired to want to do something on a great scale. He says, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond. I believe in the Greek, Pastor, it's hupa ek perisos hupa. He is able to superabundantly surpass all superabundance of anything we could ask, think, dream, or imagine. The problem is we don't imagine. We don't dream enough. We don't dream enough. We don't imagine. And we put limitations on ourselves. In Psalm 78, they limited the Holy One of Israel. They pulled back, fully armed in the day of battle. They pulled back and they limited the Holy One of Israel. And you know, we do that. We limit what God can do. If God says he's able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything we could ask or think, he means that. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Have I not said it? Not said it? Will I not do it? Forever, O Lord, thy word has been established in heaven. There has not failed one of all of his good promises which he made unto Moses his servant. If God says it, it happens. He's not a man that he should lie. If he said that he can do exceedingly beyond anything that you could ask or think because of the power that right now, the dunamis that is now resident within you, he means it. He wants to astound us. He wants us to live in amazement. He wants to outpour his glory so that we stand in total, utter amazement at the hand of God. I don't know many Christians that can say they're living in a place where they're in utter astonishment. You guys have seen astonishing things. Some of the things that have happened in Nepal, China, and happening out of this church. But let me tell you, you've just seen mercy drops. I was in a meeting one night. We're worshiping and suddenly coming down everywhere were like silver droplets, like mercury. I was actually leading the worship of all things, and my singing is not phenomenal, but mercy drops were just boom, and a person would fly down under the power of God. Bingo, and about two or three people would scatter under the power of God, and bang, bang, and I stepped back, and the Lord said, you're seeing mercy drops, but the day will come when you will stand before uncountable multitudes and see my thunderstorms. this thing gets contested. But God wants to exceed anything that we're imagining. How big are you dreaming, Dan? What are you dreaming? What are you dreaming, Ellie? Is there a stadium big enough, Pastor Mark, to handle the crowds that we're going to see coming? Is there a nation that can stand against the onslaught of the sheer roaring terror of God as he roars out of heaven? My Bible tells me God's getting ready to roar. There's a roar. When the Lion of Judah, when the Lion of the tribe of Judah roars, he declares his territory. When he roars in Nepal, he declares it belongs to me. When he roars in America, I mean, the devil would like to think he has America by the throat right now, but the news is it only needs the breath of God. It only needs the breath of God. See, on the day of Pentecost, 120 people were in an upper room with no idea what was going to happen, just an expectation on a word, when suddenly, out of heaven, there came a sound like a violent rushing wind and filled that room. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and there appeared tongues of fire on their head, and they began to speak in the language of the Elamites, the Perizzites, the Hittites, the traffic lights, and the Balaitites. Every nation where there were proselyte Jews, they heard them speak Egyptian, they heard them speak in Cappadocian language, they heard them speak in the language of the Parthians and everybody else around the place, and they were amazed because these ordinary men, fishermen, ordinary people, one of them was probably blind Bartimaeus. Could have been. Who knows? He followed Jesus in the way. Mary was there. Peter and John were there. Who knows whom some of those other characters were? Who knows? Maybe Zacchaeus made it. Lazarus was probably there. Who knows in that 120? Pastor Mark knows. He knows every one of them and their mother-in-law's name, date of birth. I'm just making it up as I go. I don't know. It's probably heresy I'm telling you, but they were there. And suddenly there's a sound of a violent rushing wind. And in one moment, God said, Holy Spirit, it's time. And the world changed. One breath. One breath. You say, my business is struggling. All you need. One breath. My marriage is struck. I'm sick. I was looking at a scripture tonight. I was going to preach on something altogether different, but just felt a bit more ferocity. But I want you to have a look in the book of Joel with me, the little book of Joel. It's only a small book. Three chapters of sheer dynamite. Three chapters of prophetic ferocity. You know, they talk of the major prophets and the minor prophets. Some of these little books, book of Zechariah, little book of Joel, little book of Habakkuk, some of these books are so loaded that you could spend a year studying the book of Joel and only just get warmed up. But I want to look at Joel chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 9. Now, it reads like this, and we need to look at it in context in a moment and who it's being spoken about, but it says this, proclaim ye this among the Gentiles, prepare a war, prepare war, wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near, let them come up, beat your plowshares into swords, your pruning hooks into spears, and let the weak say, I am strong. I am a gabor. I'm a warrior. I'm a conqueror. I'm a tyrant. I'm unstoppable. And come and gather yourself round about. Cause the mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened. Come to the valley of Jehoshaphat. For there I will sit to judge all the heathen round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. come down. The press is full. The vats overflow for the wicked. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord shall also roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. And so on. Here's an interesting scripture. And I've heard it preached many times. It's a challenge to the church to wake up. But who's it being written to? It is actually the biggest challenge to a gunfight in history. It is a challenge from God to the nations of the earth that have blasphemed his name. And God is saying, call a war. Wake up, you mighty men. All you mighty men that blaspheme my name. All of you so-called warriors. All you great men that oppose everything to do with godliness and life. There is a time and a moment. It's high noon. And God says, come and meet me in the valley of Jehoshaphat. The name Jehoshaphat, God sits in judgment. And he says, basically it's God saying, bring it on. You want a showdown? You've fought me. You've opposed me and you've hated me. You've persecuted my church. You've killed my prophets. And now you've blasphemed my name. You've cursed my name. It's time for you to come and meet me head on and bring the strongest and the best. Bring your best, because we're going to have a showdown. But see, I think we can look at this scripture and look at it, and I think there's almost a sense where God at the same time is stirring his church. And as I read this, he stirs me. And he says to me, wake up, mighty man. Don't get tired. Don't get worn out. Circumstances come against your life to crush you. The devil throws them at you. I was just telling Pastor Mark back home, my daughter who came out of shocking drug situation some years ago, went to Bible college, topped the Bible college, had a little family that were just going on so well for God, and circumstances happened and the whole family's in absolute disarray and chaos and demonism. And everything about it, I get phone calls, and for a while there I get phone calls from my daughter and I would just shake with a whole demonic onslaught to bring you down and to break your heart and to take your courage, because the devil's a discourager. But the thing about it is that sometimes he needs to understand that he picks on the wrong people. Sometimes you can just pick on the wrong person. Sometimes you just ought not. Sometimes you just need to realize that you're just pushing it too far, and you may just rise up something that you can't handle. And there's got to be something within us that says, devil, throw what you will. Throw what you will. Because there's something in my spirit that will not be stopped, that will not be shut down, that will not give up, that will not lie down. Wake up, you mighty men and mighty women. The word is gabor, 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 gabor. Warrior. Wake up, you warriors. Wake up, warriors. Put on the whole armor of God. In duo, clothe yourself in the whole armor of God. Whole armor. Put on the whole armor. The word for whole armor basically is the whole weaponry. Hoplon is weapons. The two Greek words, pas hoplon, make up the word panoplia, which is the full weaponry. The Romans didn't get dressed to defend. The Roman armor, when Paul wrote the letter to the Ephesian church, he was almost certainly had a 3-foot chain from him to a member of the Praetorian Guard, who he witnessed to constantly so that the soldiers were getting saved left, right, and center, and Caesar's own household, Nero's household, was being saved, and it seems likely that his wife, was it Olympia or whoever it was also saved. Members of Nero's own household were getting saved because the prisoner had turned the guards into his prisoners. And he wrote to the Ephesian church and he said, put on the whole armor of God that you might stand. Put on the panoplia. Put on the full equipment. Take the whole weaponry. You're not just a Christian, you're a warrior. You're born for battle. There's something about being born for battle. My great uncle went from a private to a major general from the beginning of the First World War to the end and finished up the highest decorated Australian soldier, I think, or one of the highest decorated in the taking of Jerusalem and the defeat of the Ottoman army, the Ottoman Empire in the Middle East. Born for battle. I got some of those genes in me. There's a warrior in here. Sometimes the warrior gets a bit tired, but a bit jet-lagged. A sore knee needs a miracle. I've commanded this knee. This knee is taking a hammering. I've got people all over the world attacking this knee. It's being assaulted in prayer. But God's not raising up just a pack of Christians getting around with a big Bible that sort of learned to call God, God. Almighty God, yea, we come to thee this very night, yea. He's looking for a generation that won't be stopped. He's actually looking for the most courageous generation that have ever lived. I love what Napoleon said. Napoleon called all his troops. He was a good general, old Napoleon. Called all his troops. He needed some men whose chance of coming back from this battle was around about minus 7%. And he called his army together and he said, I am looking for a group of men that do not even understand the word fear. Guys that are raised up, fearless, and nothing is too... He had so many volunteers, he had to turn them back for a mission that would probably cost them their lives. Volunteering to go in. You read of men in war. Oh, Marines. U.S. Marines who, over on Guadalcanal, I touched on it this morning, fought there, and I've been on the battle sites there. I said to the kids up there, can you get me some bullets up on top of Bloody Ridge, where Edson, was it Merritt, Edson, the Rangers up there, is a very key group of guys. They fought up there until from the top of that hill right down to the river, which is about a mile, was just a carpet of Japanese that, and they fought so brutally on that hill. And the kids came back 15, 20 minutes with a full bucket, a bucket filled with 45s and live ammunition and 50 cal machine gun. And I thought the fighting up here at a different time must have been unbelievable. As young men, 17, 18, 19 years of age, would not be moved, would not be shaken, took their stand. Immovable! And there's something. It's time in America for Christians that are immovable, unshakable, steely-faced, setting their face like flint. Got the eye of the tiger. Do you remember the old eye of the tiger? It's the eye of the tiger. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da that had been wounded and had come back into their unit. But they said that when they came back, there was a look in their eye. There's a look in their eye of defiance. There was a change. Some of you have been wounded in this battle. Some of you have been through it in your family. Some of you have been through massive rejection. Some of you have been through painful situations, but you've come back with the eye of the tiger. There's something on you that says, I've just gone another step into battle. I'm just equipped again with just a greater dimension of the power of God. There's just a greater sense of resolve. Devil, you tried to knock me out. And now you're going to wish that you never did try. He tries to knock you out, but there's something happens when you keep on coming. When you're wounded, but you come back with the eye of the tiger, and you get hurt again, but you come back, and the eye just has a bit more steel in it. And there's something in your spirit that resonates with just a little bit more tenacity. Just a bit more ferocity. God's called us to be ferocious. Someone said to me, Tim, how do you operate now? In your late 60s, how do you operate? I said, I work on the old dog principle. I sit on the veranda, relaxed. The young dogs run around the backyard chasing their tail and chasing cats. But I'm waiting for the postman. And I'm saving my energy. I'm not running around the backyard racing here and racing there. I'm on the veranda watching, steely-eyed, planning my attack. The postman normally comes here. Well, they used to in the old days. And when he comes, I shall be ready. I shall launch with a strike so fierce that he won't know what struck him, and I shall return here to the veranda with a great big piece of his trousers hanging out of my mouth. And the young dogs run around the backyard like lunatics, trying to find out who they are, but the old dog waits, retaining his energy for the strike. Lazy, perhaps. And suddenly there's the sound. I mean, we don't even have postmen anymore. Don't even have letters. My PA didn't know how to put a stamp on an envelope. Didn't know how to fill out an envelope. She said, what is that? It's an envelope. How do you fit it in your computer? You don't. I mean, at church, there's a kid sitting there and a kid sitting there, and they've got to get some information across. They don't turn across and say, can you fix this? Send an email. Sorry, I'm tangled up at the moment. I'll get back to you. Stupid age. Postman. You hear the blowing of his whistle. That's what they used to do. A letterbox. Anyone heard of one? And he's getting closer. As he gets closer, the anointing gets on you. It's a postman biting anointing. And then as he gets close, you pick your attack and you launch off that veranda like a startled gazelle. Ferocious. The eye of the tiger. All you can see is his trousers. You're aiming for his left buttock. You launch, rent a great portion of his garment, exposing his red and white spotted undies. Leave a few teeth marks to remind him not to bring letters to this house. Then, with the cloth hanging from your teeth, you go back to the veranda, and the young dogs come around and say, what happened? And you just go, and they go, that dog is incredible. The dog's just been beat up a lot of times. That old dog has been smacked from pillar to post. But the old dog has just got a bit of an eye of the tiger and a bit of a tenacity. And even though he looks pretty tame and delicate, if you're the postman, vicious. a vicious mongrel. The rest of the time, the kids can pat him. They can put flea powder on you. They can wash you. Kids can come and pull your ears. And you just, they say, he's just such a nice dog. He's the nicest dog. But the postmen have a different story down at the post office. Don't go to number 3 Linfield. Have you been there? Yes, have a look. 7 stitches in the right cheek. How about you? Similar. How many trousers? Numbers. The dog had taken enough trouser to make a whole new series of suits for the guys, storing them up in his photo album. Someone said, are you ever going to retire? They said, what's kept you doing this all these years? And I thought, I don't know what else to do. It's just what I do. It's what I want to do. Why don't you retire and do what? Why retire when you can stand before multitudes of people and see the glory of God and the power of God? Wake up, you mighty men. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles, the methodias, the methods of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. From the word arche, which is like the premier, the first, the ones that have probably been around the longest, the ones of authority and the ones that were there probably from the beginning, the ones that have hung around and know it all. We wrestle against the arche, the principalities, powers, Susia, authorities, world rulers, cosmocrateros, powerful forces in the cosmos, wicked spirits, pneumaticus paneros, wicked, malevolent, foul, stinking, dirty spirits. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that you might withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. It's time to stand. Someone say stand. 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 What a time. What a time to, what a time to be born. What a time to be in the kingdom of God. What a time. What a time. Take unto you the whole armor. Your loins girt with truth. Breastplate of righteousness. The armor of light. Arise, shine, because your light has come. Your illumination has come. The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. Gross darkness will cover the earth, and gross darkness the people, but the Lord shall arise upon thee. That word arise, he will shoot beams of divine light out of you that will scatter the darkness. Hey, have you ever read Isaiah 60? It is incredible. I'm going to read it because I just need to hear it. I'll put my glasses on. You say, where's your faith? I don't know. What am I looking for? Isaiah 60. Have a listen to this. Just listen to this. This is just, I can't find it, but listen to it. Arise. Be illuminated. Be illuminated with the glory. The Bible says of Jesus, he was the express image of God, stamped as it were. I think the word is the effulgence, the express image of God, stamped as it were with a signet ring into human flesh. And we are joint heirs with him, filled with the same power, clothed with the same anointing, immersed and baptized into the same liquid fire. Arise and be illuminated, for your lightning has come. Your lightning. Baptized in the Holy Ghost and lightning fire. The glory of the Lord. Is that the kabod? Is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness will cover the earth. And this term gross was used a long time ago. Gross darkness. The people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee. Shine out of you. Let it shine. And his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles are going to come like insects to the light. They're going to come. The Gentiles are coming to you. Not only the Gentiles, kings are coming to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes. They're coming from everywhere. They gather themselves together. They come to you. Your sons will come from afar. Your daughters shall be nursed at thy side. Then you'll see and flow together, and your heart shall fear and be enlarged, because the abundance of the sea, the multitudes shall be converted unto thee, and the forces and the wealth of the Gentiles shall come to thee. Multitudes of camels will cover thee. I can't wait. The dromedaries of Midian and Ephah will come, and they'll bring gold and incense and show forth the praise of the Lord. It's pretty incredible. The sons of strangers, verse 10, will build up your walls, and their kings shall minister to thee. Leave your gates open continually, for they shall not be shut day or night, that men may bring unto you the wealth of the Gentiles. Keep your gate open so that wealth can pour into your situation like it's never been seen before. Wake up, you mighty men. Wake up, mighty men, mighty women. Beat your plowshares. I love this. Are we right for time? You don't like sermonettes here anyway, do you? Sermonettes are for Christianettes. We can go and watch a movie for an hour and a half. I watched some absolute rubbish the other day. I sat there, didn't even eat popcorn. I just sat there. And I nearly went to sleep. And then all these stupid Avengers started fighting each other. And I thought, what a pack of idiots. And they didn't even hurt each other. Didn't even. They're hitting each other, dropping, running over each other with trucks. And no one even got a bruise. I thought, that's not a proper fight. So what a lot of nonsense. Who writes this dribble? Oh, no, just the world's gone nuts. It has. The Western world's certifiable. Anyway, beat your plowshares into swords, your pruning hooks into spears. You know what that is? That's taking basic everyday implements. Implements that are just used in maintenance, and turning a boring world of maintenance into a world of battle and excitement and conquering. Taking the mundane and turning it into something powerful. Taking our maintenance and turning it into battle equipment. Taking hold of the gifts of God. Christianity should never be a boring thing. If Christianity is boring, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. If we're bored with our Christianity, we're in trouble. We're in a lot of trouble. If we're bored, most boring. I think church can be. I'm going on record as saying this. I think it's possible to be a churchgoer and experience the ultimate boredom ever organized for humanity. In a dead church I sat through church as a kid. You had to make your own excitement. We had a lady that played a little pump organ. Have I told you this story? You have? She used to wear a hat with a rim. And we had to entertain ourselves. Church was so boring. I mean, the most exciting thing was the ivy growing up the wall. The only way to excite yourself in that church, we would have peanuts. And we would flick them her direction as she played to see how many peanuts we could leave in the rim of her hat. Back in those years, you had to be a pretty good shot, because the women wear hats to church to show they're in submission to their husband. Often that hat had a jungle, animals, birds, bowls of fruit, refrigerators, anything. Just the hats were unbelievable. The women would come in these hats. My auntie used to come to church with a fox round her neck. I told you this story, haven't I, Pastor? With a clip and these beady glass eyes. And I was a little child. And she would grasp me to her breast, smothering me with my face driven against the face of a fox. I was a traumatized child. Well, Auntie Eva would put more rouge on her face that as she walked around, it just dropped off. She left a trail. And they, oh gosh, those aunties used to give me a hard time. Praise God. That's got nothing to do with the message. Just a bit of jet lag set in. I have no idea how I went there. Where was I? Yeah, church. It was so boring. It was so boring. I don't think boring was a hard enough word. You sat through. You sat through it. You got through the hour. You sang the same hymns. You heard a message on basket weaving in Fiji. And you were bored. Bored to a point of, oh God, I used to watch the green carpet up the middle and practice my bowling for cricket. Mentally, I had to be doing stuff. I did look at the girls that were there a lot because I was bored. And it hasn't changed a lot. That still happens, the young brothers. When the worship's on, they're looking around.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Correct, Josh? No, fair enough. No? No. No? I'm joking. When did you first spot Ellie? There you go. During worship? You're up here. She was worshiping God. And you're going, oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your dad was going, no. I had it. Put ye in the sickle. Assemble yourself together. Multitudes in the valley of decision. Listen. God is looking for some warriors. God is looking for some people who would say, hey, God, you're able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything I could ask or think. The nations are waiting for me. I am a candidate. Would you put upon me an anointing of power to the nations? Would you stir my spirit? Would you open a way? Would you show me what I have to do? Would you show me how to prepare? Would you show me how to put myself in position? The people in this place that are going to see the most remarkable manifestations of God, both in America and across the earth. You know, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man all that God has prepared for those that love him, but he is revealing it by his Spirit. I just keep hearing him say, Tim, you believed for big crusades. Now I want you to believe for nations. In the last 12 months, the contesting has been huge. But we've entered the greatest day. How many people tonight in this meeting say, Jesus, my heart is for the nations in evangelism. My heart is for the nations. The whole congregation. I want you to stand for a moment. Now, I don't profess to be someone who's arrived at everything that I'm wanting to see happen, nor do I profess to have touched anything like the bonkies of this world or many of the greats of history, but God has privileged me to see a lot of things and learn a lot of things, and he's given me a gift, the capacity to see people in the kingdom of God and see breakthroughs. I want you to lift your hands. Now, just think about that scripture in Ephesians where he says, I pray the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, Son of God. Hallelujah. 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 In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah said, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And God spoke to him and said, who will I send? Who will go? And he said, here I am, Lord. Send me. Here I am, Lord. Send me. I wonder if there's someone that would say, here I am, Lord. Send me. Here I am, Lord. Send me. Just let his anointing come on you. And begin to let your mind, let him take hold of your thinking. Let him, some people sort of say, hey, you're not supposed to, you know, New Age thinking and meditating on stuff and so on. No, they steal that from the Bible. Meditation's great if you're meditating on the Word of God and the promises of God. And gosh, there's something happening in the midst here. Sister, just come. Sister in the second row, just come. Sister, I've forgotten. In the black, just come. Bring sister in the front row. Ladies, a couple of ladies first. My dad always said, ladies first. Just come. Just come. Sister, you come. Thanks, Tyler. Come up with me. Fire! Jesus. Fire! Take it all. Take it all. Just take it. Take it. Let the glory of God come on you. Let the glory of God come right through you. Brother, God sorted you out this morning. Some stuff was happening. Come back here. Come back. I don't know what happened to you this morning. Come up here. But oftentimes we just got to get up and, where's my friend Brad? Where's Brad gone? Where's Brad? Where's Brad? Where is Brad? Where is Brad? Where is Brad? Where is he? Where is he? Brother, it's a new day. It's a new day. It's a new day. It's a new day. It is a new day. It's a day to seize hold like never before and step out and dare to let God, dare to believe God, dare to trust God. Trust him. You can trust him. You can trust him. You can trust him. My God, the anointing right now. Come here, Brad. Come over here. I love this guy. So much of God on him. It's been a slow process, Brad. It's been slow but sure, but you've been true and you've been faithful, and God knows that and he understands that, and you've put your family in a good place, and you've raised a beautiful bunch of kids and got a lovely wife, and you guys, you're a blessing. You're a blessing, and God's hands on you, and he knows your desires. And he's going to show you how to piece him into place. He's going to show you how to move to that next phase in the power of the Holy Ghost. Nearly good catching, not quite. Dan and Summer, come up here. I'd have to say that I love seeing you two together. They came in last night and it was just a highlight for me of just seeing you just so happy, because you two can do anything. You got a lady here, she'll go anywhere, she'll do anything. You say we're off to China, we're off here, we're off there, all right, she'll go, won't you? Here we go, send me, I'll go, send me, I'll go. The nations are waiting for you. The doors are going to open significantly. You are called with an anointing to break chains and break open nations. God gave you tenacity a long time ago. Dan, he gave you a very resilient toughness in God, but a softness together. You got a heart that is soft, but you've got a warrior spirit. And you do want to break chains. And together, you're going to be formidable. Together, one will put 1,000, but you two will put 10,000 and hundreds of thousands. Multitudes upon multitudes. And God's going to impart an anointing so that as a team, you're going to be a hand and a glove. As a team, you're going to flow together, and somehow you're going to handle the Word of God in a strong way. You're going to carry the Word of God in a very strong way. And He's given you prophetic insight, and often you pick things up and you go, I sort of understand that or see that. And often ahead of time, you pick things up in the Spirit, and He's going to develop that prophetic anointing on your life. And together, I really feel the Lord saying that the church is built on the foundation of the apostle and prophet. And I think together, the two of you are going to fulfill areas, apostolic and prophetic, and open ground and break things, not just in this country, but across the earth for the glory of God. And the Lord would say, take off any limits. There are no limits. There are no limits. And tonight, the anointing's going to come upon you both in a way that is strong and new, with a possessing anointing that is going to be absolutely another level in the miraculous, in the fire of God, and in the life of God.
Father, right now, fire!
cleanse of Judah like a shovel. A shovel of coals in among the dry sticks. And they shall devour on the right and on the left. In that day, I will make the clans of praise, Judah praise, like a shovel of white hot coals among the dry sticks, starting fires, fire starters, people full of the glory, people full of the glory. Let's catch the fire. Tala, Jesus, holy fire, holy fire, holy fire. With Lizzie, one of my favorite people, Lizzie, Jesus, doing the most extraordinary things. Fire! Fire on the apostle. Tyler, 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 do not leave me nor forsake me. Healing. You get a heat in there. You got a, is it, which hand's hot? Both. Hello, kids. Blessed. 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 Jesus. Jesus. There's friends that you really want to see get saved, people that you want to see get saved. God. Tremendous gathering anointing. Tremendous gathering anointing. Tremendous anointing to gather. Just let the anointing come on you. That's life-changing. That's life-changing. That's life-changing. That's life-changing. That's life-changing. I feel it. It's you and him. Jesus. Jesus, gift of the Holy Ghost. How you going, Randy? Notice you tried to escape out through the door this morning under the power of God. Miracle power. I really personally have a great love for the Whites. The White brothers. My mother was Jessie Black. That was her maiden name. And I used to, my best friend was Brian White. And I'd take Brian White up to see the Blacks. And apparently both names, White and Black, were names given by the MacDonald clan in Scotland to those that were cattle rustlers. And the MacDonalds didn't want their name brought in. So if you're a cattle rustling family, Black or White. And so we've learnt something about you, Randy, tonight, that you've got cattle rustlers in your family from Scotland. Apart from that, you're a really nice guy. Oh, I want that brother on the end next to you. And you come too, brother with a beard. Bring brother next to you. Bring Sister Stripes over there. You can take a seat if you want, or you can stand if you'd like. This is my good friend who I forget every time, but not Ben, Adam exactly. I haven't known him for donkeys, known him since he was four. No, not quite. How are you, Adam? Fire right through you. What's your name, big fella?
David.
Come here, David. You are a big lump of a man, David. A big chunk of humanity. I wouldn't argue with you. If you said jump, I'd ask if I was allowed down yet. God's taking you deeper, David. God's saying to you, I want you to dig deep wells. I want you to dig deep in the Word. I want you to dig deeper in prayer. You've got a good personality and you're a likable guy. You've got a lot of good natural talents. But God says, I want you to put the roots down now in the Spirit like never before. I want you to begin to mine out the Word. not just to seek the word, but mine out the treasure of the word and hunger for it until you become like Apollos of old. In the fact, the Bible says in the book of Acts, chapter 18, right at the end, it says Apollos was a man mighty in the scriptures who powerfully refuted the Jews and in public and proved from the scriptures that Jesus was the Christ. God wants you to be a wordsman. He wants you to be a man handling the word in a very strong way, in a very rich way. And you're going to find that as you intensely go after the word of God, you're going to find there's going to be a transformation in your life so powerful that in 6 months you will not even recognize yourself, and you will watch God take hold of the word that is in you. See, God's not, we often think it'd be great to get invited places to preach. God will only take you to a place that needs what you've programmed into yourself or what he's programmed in. And so he's not going to just take you to preach somewhere because he likes you. He's concerned about the word going into those people. And if we haven't taken the time to get that word burning within us, why would God take us to minister to them if we don't have a word to give them? So if we take the time to program deeply and pour the word into us, then he will take us to vast numbers of places that need the stuff that we are learning and understanding. So program it in, David, like never before. Go after it like a drowning man. I think Brad's, come step further forward, blow. Brad's in danger yet again. Come up this way. Crawl off a bit, Brad. Father. Jesus! Yep, moved him just enough. Did you have a dream at some stage about souls? Did you have some dream that shook you up about people getting saved? Was there something, a vision or a dream or something that shook you up a little? Well, maybe God's going to give you something and just show you his passion for souls. You have a passion for souls, but he is going to do something to stir you, maybe even tonight, and show you his love for the harvest field, because he wants you to touch it. He wants you to be part of his harvest field, bringing it in. And I think you're only a little person in a sense, but you've got a big heart. Now I can feel that there's a lion's heart in there. There's a lot of courage in you and a lot of strength. And God, in Jesus' name, let a mighty firebolt of power. Firebolt. 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 Spirit of the Lord, someone, where's Tyler. Over behind sister, my friend. Don't go too quick. Someone could be killed in the rush there. That's well done. Yeah. Hands up, sister. Healing power right through your body. Look at me. Power right now, right through you. Yeah, it's still on her. There it is. Fire from heaven. Come here, brother. Prayed for you this morning. Yeah, you come up. No. Come up, William. Jesus. Bring the brother as well, though. Brother Philippines, you come over here. Jesus. Father, call of God's on you, Will. You know that. Call of God strongly on your life. Question is, what do I have to do to position myself? Zechariah went up a tree. I'm not suggesting you do that. But Zechariah positioned himself. Blind Bartimaeus positioned himself for a miracle. In the things of God, we've got to position ourselves by the things we do, by the things we grasp, what we put ourselves into, what we allow to happen. God's going to give you a strategy. to release you to the dimension of God and your great dimension, great dimension, great dimension of God with healing and miracles, healing and miracles, healing and miracles. Miracles. Someone has arthritis in your neck, arthritic neck. Just come. Would you come right now? Come over here in the arthritic neck healing position. How's your, where's your sunglasses gone? You had sunnies on this morning, didn't you? Were you? Do you get migraines? Don't get them anymore. Don't get them anymore. Is it to do with your neck? It may be. Did you have a whiplash or something?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Are you in pain with it? Are you in pain right
Thank
now?
You, Father, right now.
I'll tell you what I want, I'm going to do. I'm going to take you by the hands, and I'm going to lift your hands. And when we get to the top,
I want you to believe God that every crazy thing you've been doing, including migraines, will you believe with me right now?
Thank you, right
now. Are you ready? In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, every trace of it, go!
Base of the spine, damage at the base, and sciatic pain down one side. Who's that? Base of the spine and sciatic pain. I want to pray for you. Just come. Just come. If that's you, just come. Damage of the base of your spine and pain down into your leg. Sciatic pain, I believe they call it. Who's that? Would you come? Would you come? God bless you, sir. We met before. I met you last time, didn't I? We're here.
Praise God for the healing anointing right now.
Come over here, sir. Just come over here. That's it.
Oh, the glorious healing anointings right here, right now.
Lift your hands up to God. How are you, sir? Ready? Ready? You ready for a miracle?
As I lift your hands, I want you to believe every trace of it's going. He's there. Every trace of it. Every trace of it. Every trace of it. Right. No! Jesus' name.
Every trace. Every trace. Every trace. Who's got the glue? Who's got a wheat allergy? Who's got a wheat allergy up here? Who's allergic to wheat products? Would you come? Gluten, wheat, just come, wherever you are. Just come. Just come. Just come. Any food allergies, come now. Any food allergies, come. Jesus. Any food allergies? I tell you what, Tyler, just a thought right now. If you got that water for me, I think we could, it'd probably help me. Hello, sister. Come up this way. Just come through. What are you suffering with? Thanks, Tiles. Stay behind her. What are you suffering with, sister? Power of God's on you. Hallelujah. It's not bad water. It's good water. Let healing power flow through your body right now.
Come to the fountain.
Heal you suffer with shortness of breath. Maybe you got asthma. Maybe you just get shortness of breath. Just want you to come. High blood pressure, wants you to come. So is that a word of knowledge? Word of faith right now, really. There are areas that I've got faith for a miracle for you.
Come to the fountain.
Just come. Heart condition.
Healing
blood
waters.
Pressure.
Come
shortness
to the
of breath,
fountain
asthma
of life. Come to the fountain, healing waters. Come to the fountain of life.
I'm pretty glad I'm a Christian, you know. How'd you be not being saved? How bad would that be? Imagine not knowing if you're saved.
Healed right now. How's the neck?
It's almost all the way better. It's like...
You've got rotation.
That's right.
Oh, I tell you what, nothing.
Every trace as it goes back.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And that other thing, whatever it was. Yeah. Another one of the Spitzers. Hello, Charity. Yeah, I know. Have it. 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 Filled and healed. How you doing, bro? We'll sort sister out first. Come around this way. So you look lovely tonight. I love that. Oh, that is beautiful. Yeah. Come in, sister. Come around. Well, anywhere. Just help her. That's it. What's your name? That's a nice name. Where were you born? Bob, I've been there. Yeah. Several times. Big city. Yeah, yeah. Well, Father, that's the anointing on you right now. Here we go. And take your healing. Yeah, he's got you. Tyler's got you. That's what happens here. We've got Tyler. We have Tyler. What are we praying for, bro? Little fella, you? You got high blood? You don't want that. Normal. What? Look after them. Oh, dear. Couple of catches. Quickly, help me. Help me, there's action. Well done. Nice work. He's right, he's sneezing there, he's happy. Healed in Jesus' name. Sister, power of God's on you to make you whole. Make you whole. Make you whole. Who gets migraines around here? You do. Often? Look up here. Go! Like she was shot. What are you suffering with, sister? You got healed this morning from bronchitis this morning and shortness of breath this morning. Lift your hands. Fire! She's over. She's over. She's over. Hello, sister. You need a healing just as you feel. Come. Just come. Need a miracle? Come here. My God. Open. If you need a healing, just come. Just come. How are you down there, Stewie? You know Stewie? He's a very wonderful man. He's a doctor, aren't you? You're a gynecologist. What was it? What? Babies? I knew it was babies. So you're when they're born. Baby man. That'd be a good job. I enjoy that. Be great. I'm baby mad. I just love them. First time I came here, in Australia we say, hold a baby is to nurse a baby. And I went up to a lady, she had a beautiful baby. I said, could I nurse your baby? And she looked at me very strangely, like, looked like it's possible. But I knew that wasn't to say that again. There's things that we say in Australia you don't say here, and there's things that you say that you don't say in Australia. And I'm not going to tell you what they are. So when you come down, you'll get sprung. What do you need God to do? Lift your hands.
Thank you, Father.
Go! Go! Hello, sir. Come right over near the dock. Stay there, Doc. You're looking good, man. What are you suffering with? Go!
Oh.
I know.
Come here, brother. Brother check shirt. Let's come over here. What are you suffering with? Hands up. Go! Jesus' name, go. Sister Blue, just come. Come over here in the area here. It's becoming a bit like a goat track here. How are you? Need a miracle? What do you need? Thyroid, someone come in behind her quickly. What do you need? Father, let her thyroid come right back to normal. Are you on medication for it or anything like that? Did you? Father, overactive or underactive? Is that good or bad? Is it terrible? Healed of that cursed thing. Go! Go! Come here, Tyler. Good name. I just like saying it. Tyler. Everybody say Tyler.
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 Not Tyler. Tyler.
Tyler.
Straight down. Tyler.
Tyler.
You say it sideways. You talk sideways. Hi. I'm from America. We go, g'day. G'day. I'm from Australia. Just drop it straight off the bottom lip. Going out to get a kangaroo, mate. No worries about that, Roy. Beauty. Father, raised up to carry mighty power, mighty power. Bring him back. Mighty power. Bring him back. Mighty power. Mighty power on Tyler. He's got, leave him down. What are you laughing at, Caleb? Come here, please. Isn't it wonderful to be in church? Listen, if you've got anything to do with your bloodstream, if you've got something to do with your bloodstream, that's the red stuff that just goes round, 8 pints of it. I gave a bit away the other day. An Egyptian lady attacked me. Took a whole bunch. She's a good lady though, she gets it first shot. Straight out. Just getting a bit of blood work done. Fortunately, the first step was good. It came out the right color. So when it comes out green or something like that, you know there are gonna be a few problems. I don't even know why I'm telling you this rubbish. Call of God. Father, inject. 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 Fire! It's the old dog off the veranda, now relaxed again. You've got just champion kids. Some of my best friends in all of America. My closest friends. Snake. Josiah. Dude. And little gorgeous one by the name of... What's her name again? Yeah, Siri. And she's on my phone. Siri. She answers all my questions. Power of God's on you. Just soak it. You know, one of the nice things about the anointing, it's not about me. You say, do you get a bit proud ministering in the Spirit? How proud can a piece of clay pipe be? I mean, I've never seen a clay pipe getting around going, look at me. It's all we are. Just carriers. Just pipe, really. Just a pipe. So all your hand becomes is a pipe made out of clay. That's what we are, chemical formula of clay. Value about $22 on the market for chemicals. Might have gone up with inflation. So we just lay our God-given arm and it becomes a point of contact. And we just release what He's put in us. Nothing of ourselves, fortunately, but just what He has put in us, the fullness of Him. And it just, He's filled us. And He says, let it overflow. So put your hand out and let it overflow like a river. That's what it's about. That's Michaela. I mix all you kids up. I just go, spit another Spitzbergen. It's another Spitz. Part of the dynasty. Jesus. 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 His goodness is unspeakable. Full of glory, isn't it, Snake? Jake the Snake. How many people call you by that name, Jake? Just me. I'm privileged. I like the old Snake. A few chats, haven't we? A few yarns. Jesus. So why aren't you doing anything? Because sometimes you don't need to. Sometimes you just sit and let the Holy Ghost wash over you. Hallelujah. I mean, just let Him wash over you. Let the goodness of God just come on you. Hallelujah.
Lord Jesus.
Thank you. That's it. That's it. That's it. Call to battle.
Lord Jesus.
Call to war.
Jesus, Lord Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, how we love you, Lord.
If you're in pain in your body right now, I want you to stand and lift your hands. And as we're just reaching out to God, let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go.
Jesus.
Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go out of here. Let it go.
Jesus.
Let it go. Let the glory flow, like a flowing river. Let it flow. Let it flow. Flow. Where's he's down.
Cade's on. Jesus.
Let it flow. We're just getting soaked like a sponge right now.
Jesus.
Take your healing. Take the power of God.
Jesus.
Filled.
Lord Jesus.
Filled. Filled. Filled.
Lord Jesus.
Oh, Jesus, thank you. Filled. Filled. Filled, Brother Philippines.
Filled. Jesus.
is not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Love those cowboy boots. Bless him, Lord. Bless him. Bless him. Bless young anointed white herb. Jesus, touch him. Touch him. Touch him. Touch him. Touch him. Send an anointing right through the building. Hello, sister. Ghost. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Filled. 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 And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Men brought in a bed, a man.
Yeah.
With a palsy, and they sought means to bring him in, but could find no way because of the multitude, and they left him on the housetop.
Yes.
Lowered him down into the midst before Jesus, and Jesus, seeing their faith, said to him, "Man, your sins are forgiven you." But he perceived in his heart what they were saying, and he said, "That you might know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins." He said to the sick of the palsy, "Rise up on your feet and walk." Filled. Watch it, watch out! You're over. Pastor,
everybody just stand. If you can stand, if you're on the floor, don't get up. Praise God for the healings. Praise God for the miracles. Praise God for the signs and wonders. Praise God for his presence. Praise God for his servant in the house. all of his servants in the house. We praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Woohoo! Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for these works and greater works, great signs and wonders. Father, we thank you for a people that will press in, lay hold of everything that you have, not let up until all your will is being done. Hallelujah. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, spend your day just being filled with the Spirit, speaking yourself psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, building yourself up, being ready to go up. Hallelujah. Into a higher realm of submission, surrender, yieldedness, and sensitivity in Jesus' name. Find as many people as you can. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. I mean, cooperate with God's love. It'll get stronger, more powerful. The more you love people, the stronger the love will flow. The more you lay hands on the sick, the stronger the anointing. Hallelujah.